subscribe to Sales Wala Studios, and do not forget to click on the bell icon.
When I was dubbing for Raz, Mr. Mahesh Bhatt came and told me that, you know, you're sounding very young and too sweet for this character. You know, Bipasha is a much larger built woman. She has a husky voice. You have to kind of bring more maturity into your performance. So that, I pretty much had almost finished dubbing the film when he asked me to redub it entirely.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Leisurely Baatein. My guest today is renowned voiceover artist, dubbing director, and president of Sound and Visions India, Mona Ghosh Shetty. Mona, welcome to Leisurely Baatein. How are you doing?
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. I'm doing well. Thank you.
It's been a while. We're having a chat. Still remember the memories in Bombay and our interactions. So good to see you after such a long time.
Yeah, how long has it been?
I think more than a decade. More than a decade.
Easily, yes.
Mona, I would like to start our conversation, you know, by trying to, you know, wanting to understand. You know, you've had the front row seats to what I believe as one of the greatest entrepreneurial journeys of our country, especially, you know, in media and entertainment industry, Sound and Visions. So, you know, share with us the story of start and, you know, the whole journey, because I really want to understand that, and I'm sure my viewers would as well.
Right. So this company was basically started by my mother, not with the intention of starting a dubbing company. But she was basically a performing artist. She used to be a singer. She used to sing jingles. She used to do voiceovers for ad films. She used to, you know, having come to Bombay from Orissa, and wanting to be a singer, wanting to be part of the performing arts field, you know, to survive, you have to do everything that comes your way. So I think she used to do copywriting, she used to do translation, she used to do, you know, whatever came her way. And that's how people started getting in touch with her for language versioning and things like that. And she was extremely hardworking, extremely dedicated, extremely professional in terms of the work that she took on. So people really appreciated that, and always she was extremely resourceful. She would never say no to anything. She was always up for a challenge. So I think when anybody came up with a query or with a task, she'd say, okay, fine, I'll figure out how to get it done. You know, even if she didn't know how to get it done, she would say, I'll figure out how to get it done. So that's how, you know, just one thing went to the next. And one of her old friends, Mr. Prem Sagar, got in touch with her to start dubbing the TV serials that his father, Mr. Ramanand Sagar, was producing. So we started with dubbing a show called Krishna in 92 into Bangla. From Hindi to Bangla. So that was one of the major, the first major production that she worked on. And then she continuously worked with them on many of their shows. Their family friends were the Samantas. So at the time, Mr. Shakti Samanto's son, Mr. Oshim Samanto, he was looking to get Jurassic Park dubbed in Hindi.
Right.
And so through Mr. Prem Sagar, he contacted my mom, and she said, okay, fine, I'll try and I'll put it together. And at this time, she was still working with the Government of India Tourism Department. So she did, I think she must have taken some leave, and maybe during that time we worked on it. So I used to help because of my knowledge of English. I used to help the writer, Mr. Mehr Munir, with the adaptation of the script, you know. So I'd come back from college every day, and I'd sit, he'd come over home, and I'd sit with him, and I'd explain to him that, you know, this is because some of the jokes, some of the American English, you know, just for a hardcore Hindi Urdu writer, some of it was lost on him, you see.
Sure.
So, you know, just to help him out with what things meant and how things should translate or how they can be adapted in Hindi. So, I think, by default, my initiation was also very early. So, that's how one thing Jurassic Park make history in practically every country that it released in every language that it released in.
Right.
So after that, I mean, it was just one thing after another, and we did Schindler's List, we did True Lies, we did Babe, and so many lovely, all the James Bond movies, all the Fast and Furious movies, all the Mission Impossible movies, I mean, the Mummy movies, all the fun movies that came out after that, all the lovely franchises, we worked on all of them, and my mother would be the dubbing director, and people really appreciated her skills as a dubbing director, even though originally Hindi was not our first language either. But, you know, just adapting to the need of the hour, adapting to the whole understanding of what the client required, being able to do that is what turned, I think, a passion and a dedication into a business. Right. And that's how the entrepreneurial journey really started. And initially, we would only work in other studios. We would hire studios, or studios would hire us. For example, like Aradhana Films, Mr. Ashim Shamanto, he would hire my mom to direct for him. Since he was very actively producing and directing content at that time. So she would direct. And then, over time, we met my husband. We started working at his studios. Then after some time, we built our own studios. Meanwhile, I had my voicing career also, where I was a voice actor. I was doing feature films. I was doing voiceovers for advertising. So, you know, parallelly, we were kind of more or less in the same industry.
Right.
So even though I had an independent career outside of Sound and Vision, it was because it was so closely related. I could always help my mom, and because I was also a freelancer, I could help my mom a lot with her work, like specifically things like adaptation, or maybe doing a character in one of her films, or with a little bit of client servicing, or help out in accounts. You know how it is when you're a two-man army. It's judo khelai ke chondi part. You're doing everything.
And precisely, and that is the reason. You know, I mean, what you hear about startups and startup founders. You know, and that's what always has inspired me. You know, when it comes to woman-led startups and the journey. You know, of what you have achieved and your late mother has achieved. I think it is phenomenal, and that's where I wanted to start, you know, understanding that, and also for my audience. Phenomenal, very inspiring.
Yeah, so I think when you start out, you do everything. I mean, we did everything, right, from scripting to casting to scheduling to dubbing to mixing to QC to corrections to accounts to contracts, and you know, right through, seeing it through to the end till the product goes out to the client. I mean, we did everything. So it was a great, great, great learning process for both of us, for my mother and I. And I think that's what really helped us establish ourselves in the industry, because we could, we really knew every part of the job minutely.
Right. Phenomenal. And obviously today, like, you know, you've got a very, very cutting edge setup, and you do work for all the leading studios in India. So well done. And I look forward to, after the COVID, to come and visit you in the studio.
Oh, please do. I'd love that.
And also give a voice test.
Yeah, sure.
Great. So Mona, you've... you've always been known as a dubbing queen of India. And
oh no, that was my mother's title. I don't deserve it at all.
So you are the approved voice of some of the leading actresses in Bollywood and Hollywood. I mean, who are some of them, and who's your favorite Hollywood actress among them?
Well, it's hard to really have favorites. You know, when you're a performing artist, you see something good in everyone. You know, it's really exciting to dub for many of the greats. Like, I really used to love dubbing for Catherine Zeta-Jones. I used to think the kind of films she did, the kind of acting she did, I could really, I really enjoyed that. I used to enjoy dubbing for a lot of the Hindi films that were going on, you know, a lot of the Bollywood actresses. I did some work for Angelina Jolie, Halle Berry, Cameron Diaz, I'm trying to think of some of the names, Mila Jovovich, yeah, a lot of actors. You know what happens is when these films, big films, come to you, you basically are asked to carry out auditions, and so naturally, you know, because in the beginning there weren't that many choices of voice actors. So for every age group and for every character and for every profile, you didn't have three options and four options to send to the client, you know.
Right.
So there'd be a lot of duplication, and there'd be, so I would naturally step in and also audition for some of these characters. And gradually, you know, you develop the confidence and you develop the knowledge of what really it takes and what it needs, what the client is looking for. So I started getting approved for a lot of the voices, and I started getting approved for a lot of the roles. And you know, dubbing for these, for such a huge variety of content, it just teaches you so much about acting. It teaches you so much about voice acting, about delivery styles. You know, and in those days in Aradhana studio, the sound engineers, especially Mr. Karnel Singh, they used to really groom us, you know, that, you know, this is not sounding right, this is not sounding right, you know, let's do it again. And you, sometimes you're saying the same line 500 times because they're not happy with the output. So the way that hones your skills, I mean, every director, every sound engineer I've worked with, I would say, has just taught me such a lot about my voice, about performance, about language, about, you know, just pushing your boundaries constantly and trying to do something better and trying to fit into the character perfectly.
Right, and you've also been, you know, you've done voice for a lot of popular Bollywood actresses of who we know, and I remember, like, you know, watching Ghulam many, many years back when I was in Canberra doing my master's, and in my dingy small room, we had a video and we got a cassette, and you know, I said, like, you know, this voice doesn't sound like, you know, of the actress. This is a very different sounding voice. And then many years later, when we interacted, somebody told me that, you know, it's you who dubbed. And I was then in awe, like, you know, I mean, it was like, you know, phenomenal. So that was who else have you dubbed for in Bollywood?
I've dubbed for Rani Mukherjee. I've dubbed a little bit for Kajol. I've dubbed for Pooja Batra, Koena Mitra, Vipasha Basu, Deepika, Katrina, Jacqueline Fernandez, Nargis Fakhri. So a lot of the actresses, because there was also, you know, we went through this phase where top models would become actors. You know, they would they would land a film at the top of their modeling career. And they're used to walking the ramp, they're used to posing. Many of them, because they were so high up there already, there was no time to really do workshops with them or train them to act.
Right.
So they were pretty much learning everything on the job on their first film.
Correct.
So I think that process, maybe at that point of time, the directors or the producers or the actors were probably not investing so much time and effort in that process during those days, which is why I got the kind of work that I did. where I would be brought in to dub the performance for the original version because somebody's dialogue delivery is not right or somebody's voice is not right. Now, this voice is not right was a perception thing, you know, where everybody feels, oh, the Hindi film heroine has to have a sweet, bubbly voice.
Correct.
That was the voice you had to have. Correct. Or it had to be totally husky and sexy, depending on the kind of character that you play.
Right, right.
So it was always one of these two. So, you know, to get the right mood, to get the right performance, to get the right feel, to get the right tone of voice that matches someone's body language perfectly. Those are the kind of things I mastered because of working so extensively with my mother. You know, because if you're doing this 24/7, then it kind of, you know, it's second nature. It becomes second nature to you, right?
Correct.
So naturally, I mean, and in those days, what used to happen was the advertising lot. Those voiceovers would look down on film and television dubbing, and the film and television dubbing would look up to all the voiceover thing. But there was no crisscross at that time.
Mm.
Nowadays, everybody's doing everything. Things have opened up a lot, you know.
Right.
But in those days, I was one of the few people who was doing things across,
correct,
which is probably why I was getting work more easily, because, you know, there weren't that many English educated Hindi voice actors who could sound perhaps sophisticated doing dubbing for these Hindi film actors. You know, if you're playing like a spoiled rich brat or something, you know, your English has to be good,
right,
even though you're dubbing in Hindi.
Right.
The odd word can't sound very colored, can't sound very accented, you know, can't sound too desi. Or you're dubbing for someone who's supposed to be educated in London or America or somewhere, or lives abroad. So, you know, these kind of things would come very easily to me because I've grown up in England and stuff like that. So I think that was the kind of mix that really worked for me.
Correct.
You know, the my educational background, my social background, my mother's work, my work, I think all of it just came together really beautifully for the kind of work that was coming my way at the time.
Phenomenal. And you know what, it's a very, very difficult profession, and I have you know, I had the opportunity to see some work happening in various studios in my days in Mumbai, and I had a lot of friends from, you know, the voice industry at that time, including yourself. And it's people think, you know, it's you know, you just, there's a dialogue, you say it and that's it, but matching the lip, and I've seen some videos, YouTube videos of you doing on spot some you know, some scenes of other actors, probably it's not part of your project. It sounded very simple, very fluid, but that's the kind of years of experience that you know, comes into the profession. Mona, what has been some of the, maybe one of the most challenging voice projects that you've done?
Well, Raaz was extremely challenging for me. Well, I think all of them, you know, in their own way have been challenging. For example, when I was dubbing Ghulam, there was that big screaming scene that I had to do where, you know, Rani sees Aamir on the ledge of her, on the window ledge of this high-rise building that she lives in.
Right, right.
And she starts screaming away like crazy. And, you know, when you're screaming on a mic, the sound can distort very easily. And therefore, what the engineers do is to control the distortion, they bring down your levels.
Mm.
The moment they bring down your levels, the director is saying, oh, but this is not working. This is not the feel. I need much more energy. I need much more this and that. You know, all of it, you know, it's not sounding right. It's not gelling. It's not matching. So finally, I had to tell Vikram Bhatt, who was the director of that film, that can you please come and sit next to me? Then only you'll know what exactly I'm doing and whether it's matching the body language or not. So he came into the dubbing room, the artist room, and he sat next to me, and I screamed. Because, you know, if you do it over and over again, you lose your voice. So I told him, look, if let's not just keep on doing it over and over. Let's figure out where the problem is. So you come and sit next to me. Let me perform it for you once. And then if you feel that the performance is not right, then we'll work on that performance, you know. So I did that, and he like almost jumped out of his seat because I was screaming like a mad woman by then. And then we figured out, okay, between the technical and the creative, you know, how do we balance it out? So those kind of challenges, when I was dubbing for Raaz, Mr. Mahesh Bhatt came and told me that, you know, you're sounding very young and too sweet for this character. You know, Bipasha is a much larger built woman. She has a husky voice. You have to kind of bring more maturity into your performance. So that I pretty much had almost finished dubbing the film when he asked me to redub it entirely. And I've almost redubbed the entire film. Jism was a huge challenge for me because at that time I was pretty young. I had a very sweet voice. So to suddenly play this man-eater kind of woman, you know, very seductive woman, was a very difficult task for me. And someone who had no qualms saying anything to anyone.
Right.
Man, woman, or otherwise, you know, no qualms with language, no qualms with seduction, no qualms with anything. So, you know, you learn as these people push your boundaries, you push you out of your comfort zone, you learn, and each right. one comes with, you know, constantly trying, okay, how can I get this woman's tone? How can I sound convincingly, you know, like, you know, when somebody like you watches the film, you shouldn't feel that the voice and the body are a mismatch.
Correct.
The voice and the face have to match to some extent, even if it's not a real voice match with the original voice of the actor, at least it has to gel, you know, for the audience to buy it and to enjoy the film without getting distracted by the fact that it's a dubbed voice.
Correct. I mean, we often get that feel. I often get that feel, especially when you're seeing dubbed, you know, remakes of South Indian films. Not remakes, dubbed South Indian films. It's
yeah.
You have to match the lip and, you know, from a very different, from a language perspective.
So that was, though, that was very challenging. Rockstar, when I dubbed, I was... I kept on losing my voice because of the screaming sequences in that film. And every time I lost my voice, I would have to take a 1 week break and again come back after 1 week and again redub. And again, I would lose my voice. Again, I'd take a 1 week break. I felt like that dubbing went on forever. So, yeah, every film comes with its challenges and you learn something with every film.
Right. And does it ever have sounded to you or seemed to you like, you know, there could be certain dialogues which could be very over the top, you know, I mean, is...
Oh, yes. And I love melodrama. I love it. So I keep telling my friend Mayur Puri, who wrote this dialogue, who wrote the dialogues for Om Shanti Om.
Right.
I keep telling him that I have to thank you for the craziness that I have performed. I mean, who says in their daily life, "Ek chutki sindoor ki keemat tum kya jaano Ramesh Babu?" I mean, who would say such a thing? So, I mean, I just love the melodrama that comes with some of these films. I love it. I mean, nowadays, of course, films have become a lot more natural. Yeah. They are a lot more slice of life kind of films. So, you don't really get to play a character in that sense, like a crazy, like a unnatural kind of a, unreal kind of a character. I mean, I love it.
No, extremely good that you say that, you know.
Like, I've lost count of how many times I've said nahi or I've screamed. I mean,
mujhe chhod do.
Yeah, chhod do mujhe. You know, haath mat lagana mujhe. Something like that, you know, some of these really very typical responses that actors would have in Hindi films.
Right. But I wanted to understand, I mean, with COVID-19, which has, you know, pretty much disrupted all, you know, forms of industries, you know, work from home is becoming a new normal. You know, how how is your industry, you know, coping with work from home? You know, how are you adapting to this transformation?
So, you know, I mean, this whole thing just came upon us so suddenly. The lockdown came upon us so suddenly. We were totally caught off guard. We have a very high level of content security in our work because we deal with so much of pre-release content. So it was really, really hard for us to make that change because everything in our studios was built around you only can access things within the studio and nowhere else.
Correct.
So work from home was unthinkable in our lives till March.
Right.
Till April, you know,
right.
And then when we started, our clients actually started encouraging us. I would say Netflix was probably one of the first to encourage us to explore online recording systems, mm-hmm. and to explore work from home options. And we started doing some testing, and then, you know, initially everything was shut, so we couldn't even buy equipment to send out to our employees to their homes. You know, movement was not possible, so for people to come to the studios, take equipment home was difficult. So we really grappled with that the whole month of April. But with whoever had any kind of machine at home and any kind of facility to record at home, some voice actors already had small setups at home, so we had started doing some testing. One voice actor called Sahil Ved really helped us a hell of a lot because, you know, he's a bit of a techie, and being a voice actor and a techie, he kind of helped us with learning the systems and learning how internet speeds are affecting us, how configuration of a machine is affecting us, how different microphones are affecting us, all these things. You know, we learned as we went. And I think by the end of April, we kind of had cracked it, and by the mid of May we were up and running working from home. By then, of course, things had opened up a little, so we could buy laptops, we could buy Macs, etc., to send to our sound engineers, to send to our dubbing directors, mm-hmm. set them up at home with all the equipment that they needed. And, you know, kind of get, we also started a drive to educate people because, you know, obviously this was new for everybody and the whole ecosystem has to work. It right. can't just be me and my staff that are doing it. I mean, who are we going to work with? Right? So then we had to create that whole ecosystem. So we started a huge campaign on social media to educate voice actors about online recording.
Right.
About how to set up your home studio, what kind of equipment do you need? And that's how I started my Insta Live sessions in the month of May, you know, where I started talking to experts, started talking to various people about their home setups, what they did, how they went about finding stuff, the learnings, all the hits and misses, all the trials and tribulations that you go right. through before your home setup is absolutely tested and ready to go.
Right.
So that really helped people gain some confidence because people were also getting a little restless, you know, that
right.
theek hai, first you thought, okay, maybe a few days of lockdown, then you thought, okay, maybe a week, then you thought, okay, so this is going to be 3 weeks, okay, fine, 15th April we'll open up. Then 15th April became, I think, 30th April, and 30th April became 15th May, and 15th May became 30th May, and, you know, the dates just kept going forward, and then people started getting worried that, you know, how long are we going to live off our savings?
Right.
How are we going to get back on work, get back on track?
Right.
So I think that that campaign really helped people get a lot of confidence. And as people were setting up and working with us, so the word of mouth also spread
right.
that, you know, Sound and Vision has started working, and they're working with people from home, and they're doing home recordings. And we started delivering projects by the end of May. So news went out everywhere that, you know, we're already working and we're delivering projects with whatever, even if it takes a double amount of time to record from home because of our fantastic internet connections, because of our fantastic background noise.
Exactly, I was coming to that.
Such a big challenge. And all of that.
Because I always fear when I'm having these sessions, you know, and these are like, you know, the very different perspective, that, you know, somebody should not shout or somebody should not walk past trying to sell something, you know. But I'm sure it is so different. So I was about to ask you, how are you managing with that? You know, I mean, in India, it could be a pressure cooker
situation. It is difficult. We are encouraging. So you'll see on our social media handles, we are also, one of the things we post is home studio hacks. So basically, what are the ingenious ideas that people have come up with to build acoustics, to build a booth, you know?
Right.
So someone's done it in a cupboard, someone's done it in a suitcase, someone's done it in a bathroom, someone's done it on their bed, someone is under a quilt. You know, it's everyone has different things because in Bombay especially, you have tiny homes. You don't have the space for it. You have 10 people in the house. Everybody's making noise. Children are screaming. Pressure cooker is going off. People are talking. People are eating. People are on the phone. Other people are doing their work. They're on Zoom calls or whatever, you know, video calls. So it's... It is quite. And then the birds are chirping. The crows are annoying you. There's somebody driving by. There's banging going on upstairs. There's drilling going on. I mean, you name it and we probably have recorded it by now.
Right. You know, it talks about the passion of, you know, the people in the voice industry that, you know, in with all these challenging circumstances, you guys are still carrying on, delivering on projects, and that's phenomenal. And I think that's so inspiring. And I certainly would like to go and, like, you know, have another round of look onto your Instagram handle, especially those hacks. And I'll also put the link in the description for my viewers to go and have a look at it. Mona, we're almost towards the end of our...
You find Sound and Vision Studios on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. So
I'll put all the links, all the handles in the description below for my audience. Mona, we're almost towards the end of our conversation, the time that we have. The last question I wanted to ask you is, post-COVID, which is the first travel destination that you want to visit? The first holiday, where would you have to have?
I'm always a Europe person, but I think that question is a little subjective in the sense that we have to see when does post-COVID actually happen? What time of year is it? And therefore, which place is right at that time of year is probably going to be the consideration in terms of weather.
Next June.
Next June, Europe. I love Europe. I can't, every summer holiday has to be Europe.